everyone. I'm Kirsten.
And I'm Blair, I think.
And we are
mediocre content.
And we're back at
Sorry,
it again.
Sorry, I wasn't sure. I was playing because I wanted to hear the music, so I was playing our like intro in my like on my computer, and I was like, "Oh my god, what's happening?" But I wasn't sure if it was you like on the computer or if it was the real. I don't know. Anyway,
that's fine. Excellent, and I love it. Anyway, guys, Mel, I see your message. How are you? Good to see ya. Hyperlinks are not active. That's great. Love to hear it. I'll get right on that. Not surprising. I literally put it together in a couple of seconds. So, you know, that's how we roll around here. yeah, let me address that now since I'm thinking about it. I love how, like, it's scuffy regardless.
Oh, we have a cat. We have a mediocre cat.
Oh my god, cat butt.
this is the first time he's been on stream.
Hey, Chris.
This is Salem, everybody. Oh, Chris is here. Hi.
Good.
Oh, it is a void alert. It's the void.
The void. Yeah. Hey, Abby. How are you? I thought you were supposed to be sleeping. Abby, thanks so much for the follow, girl. Thank you. I'm addressing a problem. One moment, please.
Yes. You guys will just have to deal with the entertainment of me for one moment.
And a giant cat butt.
And a cat. Yes. Salem, say hi.
Oh, my goodness.
Nothing? No?
No.
Okay. Am I glitchy or am I okay? Am I doing okay?
Look how many swords are in there.
Yeah. Thank you.
Love a good fur baby.
Oh, yes.
Okay. Mel, are none of the links working? Because I'm literally going to cry. Maybe
I think she said... She said we're good. Does that pertain to the links or no?
That pertains to you.
Oh, me.
Like, you're
okay,
good.
Cool. Perfect.
Yay. Not now. Okay, there we go. Okay, that one's okay. Thanks, Abby. Yeah, we haven't posted a whole lot. You can't click them?
Also, for those, I posted on our story on Instagram, and I don't know if anyone here is from our audience over on Instagram, but I did post that it was 25 minutes till stream, and then we got on stream like 5 minutes later, so I'm sorry about that. I didn't know what the plan was, clearly.
This is acceptable behavior for us. We do not apologize.
Yeah. Mediocre at best. Not missing much. It's fine.
Okay. I can't address it, apparently. I don't know, Mel. They're letting me... everybody try the links. This is not a plug. I swear this is not a ploy to get you to check out all of our socials.
Secretly.
Secretly, I want you to follow us there. No, for real. Everybody click them. See if... It's weird. So I can click them, but I don't know if that's because I manage it. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I
you're making total sense over there, I promise.
Over here. These links, let me copy. Do any of these work for you? They're not working for Mel, which has me worried, and unfortunately...
They work for me. Hold on, let me see. Hold on.
But
let
you
me,
might be
I'm
a
gonna
manager.
Click on Yeah, let me click on our Twitter and see if it comes up.
Okay. Streamer professionals. Is it
so
because
professional.
Of the brackets? Oh, it could be because of the brackets. I could just get rid of the brackets.
So it's coming up for me, but I'm a biased party.
Fair enough. Here, let me get rid
Chris
of the
Chris says not on mobile.
Mel, are you on mobile? Also, how dare you watch me on mobile? I'm just kidding.
The man is also watching golf downstairs, I believe.
Chris, you just got back from a lesson. Maybe it's mobile. Abby, are you also on mobile? Is everyone on mobile?
That's how people watch things. It's on mobile.
I guess.
Oh, hanging up. Oh.
Same,
thanks,
same.
Babe. Cool.
Mediocre husband, everyone.
Yeah, that's right.
Always. Okay, I can't trust any of you. You're on mobile. It probably doesn't work on mobile. I'll still get rid of the brackets in case, actually, just to be safe.
Yeah.
My phone is life. Your phone is dead. I mean, you watch.
Name, though. I mean, honestly.
Your phone is always on then, because I see you in other chats.
I couldn't find my phone the other day, and I'm like running around the house trying to find it. And I'm like, well, let me see if I can like have someone call my phone.
Yeah.
So I could find it. But then I was like, well, I need my phone to like let someone know to call my phone because I was home alone. I didn't have anybody. And I was like, well, this is
predicament.
I did end up finding it, though. It was covered in my bed sheets because you know how that goes.
I mean, I am notorious for losing my phone, full transparency. I often have the moment where I'm like, you know how you just do things kind of in a habit, completely involuntary, and so your body just moves, but your brain isn't necessarily taking track.
That's exactly what happened to me.
What's happening?
I was like, I have no memory of this. Where did it go? I like went into like autopilot for 5 minutes or something. Yeah,
that's what it is. I just don't remember.
Yeah, I know.
One time my phone was like next to the refrigerator, which is never where it is. And so, of course, I'm just walking around my house. Where is it? It's like, what?
Yeah.
Where is it?
Well, and this is why I determine people, primarily the reason why people have Apple watches or like smartwatches in general is because then you can just click a little button on your wrist and it finds your phone for you. And you know, I was like, oh, I get it now.
Oh, wait, we are all clueless about where our technology is. Not to mention how expensive it is, and we're just losing it willy-nilly.
Willy-nilly.
With reckless abandon.
Also, don't talk to me about how I have a metal straw in a plastic cup, okay? I don't want to hear it.
Are you drinking your Starbucks out of a metal straw in the Starbucks cup, or is it not Starbucks at all?
This is not Starbucks. This is our local coffee shop. Shout out Acme Coffee. This is the best decaf blend I have ever had in my entire life, and it's amazing.
Oh, she's on a decaf kick at the moment.
I am. And you know, it's really helping me sleep at night. I feel less anxious all the time. So we're doing big things with the decaf situation.
Oh my, okay. So I have to tell you about also Pokemon in chat if you're interested. Abby has ordered a pool for is it your niece's? Is that who, your niece's nephews? Anyway, she's ordering a pool and she's supposed to blow it up. They're going to have splat balls so they can play with like water balloon type things because it's really hot over in the UK right now is what I understand.
Oh, gotcha. Okay.
So
got it,
like
got it.
Niece and nephew. Yeah. And so I wasn't invited, but the pool was. So.
Oh, like you're going to fly over to the UK, ma'am.
Hardly fly
Girl
my
can't
own.
Even get on a plane to fly across the country, let alone a whole ocean.
Don't out sorry. Me like that.
Sorry, Abby. I'm sorry.
Don't make it,
don't let her make you feel like that because she won't come.
Look, I just have anxiety about not being on the ground, okay?
Which is totally valid, and we validate that here, but like don't make promises you can't keep, okay?
I didn't promise. I just wanted to be part of the fun. I was very jealous. No, but the kids are going to have a blast.
Yes. Very cool. I love it.
It's a whole other thought. No, you're going to need like a pump.
No. Yeah. Yeah.
Like get a pump. It'll save your whole life.
So Salem and Jinx really like to get my cats for all y'all who don't know. They like to get in the bathtub sometimes when it's like a little bit wet, like it's only like up to, you know what I mean? Yeah. They like the like leftover shower water, you know what I mean? And
the murky water.
Yeah. And so I really think that if I got them a baby pool and just like filled it up like a teensy little bit and put their little fishy toys in there, they might be able to get in. They might like it.
You should get like that viral splash pad that's going around for all the dogs.
Oh, yeah. That's a good idea. Mm-hmm. I should definitely do that.
That'd be lots of fun. Ah, sorry nobody caught it, guys. Rigged.
Rude.
Okay. Well, let's do this thing. I have, of course, our little disclaimer. Yes. Here it is. We ain't experts. We don't claim to be. There's errors for sure, but this is a fun 1,000%
learning. 1,000% there's
errors. Mm-hmm. Rude. This is fun. It's a learning environment. We share cool stories and topics, expand our knowledge together. However, if we do mess something up, and you have insider info, please feel free to kindly let us know and do your own research. That's all I have to say.
I agree. 1,000% on board.
1,000%. And I did come up with some good news.
Oh.
So.
Wow.
Yeah. And
oh my gosh, porpoises. Okay. All right. Let's do it.
All right. We're jumping into the good news.
Can I do the good news?
Yeah, of course you can. Yeah. It's all science related, as you might expect, though.
I'm not surprised. It's not. Well, okay. Kirsten Science Corner featuring Blair. All right. Endangered vaquita porpoise population steady in the Gulf of California. So, Mexico's vaquita porpoises are holding steady in the Gulf of California. For 2 weeks in May, researchers sailed around the part of the Gulf, which is the only place vaquita porpoises, the most endangered porpoise in the world, live. Very interesting.
Very interesting.
Sorry, I just heard a bang from the other room, and I'm really hoping Chris is okay.
Chris, you okay? It's not the rage corner. You don't have to break anything. This is good news.
All right, it's okay. We're moving on. He'll message us in the chat. Okay. Good.
I'm okay.
Do I need to call? Do I need to get my nurse bag out? Okay. All right. The researchers saw at least one or two calves in the water. Ladder and twitch isn't the safest. Oh my God. You shouldn't be twitching and on a ladder at the same time. Just so you guys know. It's a bad life choice. The researchers saw at least one or two calves in the water, which was a hopeful sign. Vaquitas cannot be captured, held, or bred in captivity. Because of illegal fishing, the vaquita population has dropped from 600 in 1997. Aww. Alex Oliveira.
That's what I would Oliveira. That's what I would say.
Yeah. Yeah. The Mexico representative for the Center for Biological Diversity told the Associated Press the new research is encouraging news and it shows that vaquitas are survivors, but we still need urgent conservation efforts to save these tiny porpoises from extinction.
I love it. So cute. Don't go snapping pencils, Abby.
If you're going to break anything, grab a pencil and... Oh, that's fair.
No broken bones, I guess? I don't know.
Rage.
Rage. I mean, we're not talking about Liam Payne, so we're not in the rage corner this time.
No, we're not.
Yeah. Porpoises are adorable, but I feel really bad for these ones.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. But it's good. Things are happening.
Yeah.
Things are getting better for them. All right. Second good news story. Scientists say new data contradicts belief that morality is declining.
I was trying to make people feel better about existential crisis.
For decades, people worldwide have said that they believe morality is declining, but the new research shows that this could be a cognitive illusion. Psychologists Adam Mastroianni
sounds good to
me, and Daniel Gilbert examined surveys conducted in 60 countries between 1949 and 2019 about moral values and found that in response to 84% of the questions, most participants said that they felt morality had declined. In Mastroianni and Gilbert's own 2020 surveys, U.S. participants of all demographics said that they thought people were less kind, honest, nice, and good now compared to earlier times. The researchers then studied similar historical views. If, as people all over claim, morality has been declining steadily and precipitously for decades, then people's report of current morality should also have declined over the years, the study authors wrote. They didn't, though. And Mastroianni said that this means the perception of moral decline is either false or it has at least very difficult to find any evidence that it has happened.
Isn't that great?
Wow. That's so interesting.
Yes. And
so basically it's just all of our grandparents going like, the world has changed since I was a young whippersnapper.
And in the news.
Maybe also the increase in the terrible news.
Yeah,
we just know too much.
Well, we know too much, and I feel like they very rarely have, quote, good news stories around. So it's easy to
1,000%.
Think. Yeah, it's easy to think that maybe it's declining, but apparently not. Mm-hmm. Isn't that, that's great news.
It is good news, but it's also like kind of weird.
It is.
Yeah.
That's fair.
You're right, Chris. It is the 24-hour news cycle.
No, that's what we are. No, just kidding.
We are not. If we were, I'd be like, absolutely, I would be dead.
We are so reliable.
Well, and not just the reliable thing, but 24 hours, like, I have to sleep at some point. Well, I get very cranky.
And we're in different time zones, so that would also make things a little difficult.
It would be a mess.
All good. All right. Well, that's our good news.
Yay.
Awesome job, as usual, Blair.
Thank you so much.
See you gay hours when? Never! we just got over the fact that I'm not flying anytime soon, so.
True.
So, today, I have something fun, and I know none of you can see what I have on my desk other than a giant cat, as usual. However,
I don't see a giant cat. Where is it?
Oh, he's right here. I don't have my cat cam yet.
Oh, yeah. No, we need to get... Yes. Jinx is like right down here, so we need to...
Jinx and Lynx gets tied up in my mouth a lot, too.
Cat cam coming soon. It's happening.
Over here-ish, I have stuffs that I'm going to talk about and also show and tell today, which is so fun because I feel like on our pod, normally... I can't do a show and tell.
Correct. Yeah.
Oh, I got tons of fun for you, Abby. Also, enjoy your 4 days off.
Also, like, it's 11 p.m. in the UK.
Yeah.
Okay. Are you tired? Are you okay?
Of course she's tired.
I'm tired. And it's what, like 3 p.m. here?
Right. Okay. So this Abby
I'm in the past.
And ABI Abby are also, she's also on the other side, and she also sometimes pops in here, and I'm like, y'all need to go to bed.
Right.
Ridiculous.
I mean, do you, if you're night people, that's more power to you. I'm a morning person. I can't handle that.
Whew, you know I'm not.
I know.
Many a vacation.
You're in college, like, oh, I gotta go to bed. It's 9 p.m.
It was 8. I'm just kidding.
Low key.
Yeah.
And then she's like the only one up on campus at like 6 a.m.
You know me. Yeah, she's got time off now. So,
cool.
You know.
Very nice. All right.
Okay. So, today's topic is Beanie Babies.
Woo!
I'm starting a collection series, and I literally named it Gotta Catch 'Em All because I'm also a Pokemon nerd, and I figured if you're collecting things, that's a legitimate title to use for clickbait. So,
agreed.
Yes. So I'd like to just say all of the information, for the most part, that I gathered is from this year. So as in June 5th, 2023, the article that I pulled almost 90% of this information from was published within this month, which just goes to show, even now when you don't hear a lot about them, mm-hmm. Beanie Babies are still influential and still something that gets talked about because of how crazy it was, which I find crazy.
I would agree. Yeah, so. Definitely. I still have Beanie Babies, but they happen to be across the country in my parents' attic. So I will not be doing show and tell, but everyone please enjoy Kirsten's show and tell.
I got you covered. I've got the old, the new, the old, old.
Do you have... I saw a viral post about Beanie Babies the other day, and it was like the Princess Diana one. Do you have that one?
I don't have that one.
Okay.
But it is the most... I think it's one of the more popular ones.
Yeah. Yeah. I never had that one either, but it is popular.
I think we were too young.
Like, I think you're right. Yeah, because she passed away, I think, in 1994, right?
Is that right?
Cause or 99? I don't know.
I mean, either way, we were very, very young.
We were
babies.
Super young.
Yeah. And also, during that time, even when we did start collecting them, like, I think we were just looking at the cute ones, and not that a purple bear isn't cute.
Right.
But
no,
comparatively.
But... Right, yeah.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Probably not the one.
Like, I feel
for.
Like the bear ones were, like, the OG Beanie Babies. It's what
they
you
were.
Think of. Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. I'm sorry. I'm spoiling it.
They were.
But I always wanted to do the ones that were a little bit... 1997, thank
Thanks,
you.
Mel.
I knew our UK people would know.
Mel's from the States.
I don't know anything. Okay.
Yeah. She's one of us. One of us.
Oh,
one
God. I'm sorry.
No, you're right, though. They were the OG. And here's how it happened.
Okay, go ahead.
So... creation of Beanie Baby began in 1983 when 39-year-old and former aspiring actor, which I thought was a weird point to put in there, H. Ty Warner, who had recently either been fired from or simply chose to leave the Donkin toy company he'd worked for during much of his adult life, would open his own toy company manufacturing small stuffed animals. Just so you knows, he was fired. Just want to be very Cute. Clear about that.
We love that.
Oh, no, Mel, get out of here. modeling the go big or go home creed, Warner would invest pretty much everything that he had, including about $50,000 in inheritance from his father, who'd literally just passed away at the time, into creating this company. Fun fact that I'll share later around that. Is kind of messed up. So we'll get to kind of the messed up part later, but we're going to talk about the good stuff now, but just kind of put a pin in Warner and his inheritance and all that stuff.
Okay.
So first round of toys he had were called Himalayan cats, which I thought was hilarious and
Very
interesting.
Cute.
Abby. But they quickly sold out in all the local stores, which was great. And what set the stuffed animals apart were plastic pellets used instead of the conventional stuffing material that you might know. Pokemon in chat, which I think is also a cat, ironically. So the toy in general had kind of more of a posable, less stiff feeling to a traditional toy. And his competitors originally thought that that was ridiculous and compared them to roadkill, actually, because they would like flop around and, yeah. you know, weren't rigid.
Mm-hmm.
People apparently thought they wouldn't take off, of course, which is, I think, the start of the majority of people that take off is people who are like, nah, it'll never become anything. And then suddenly
right.
it explodes.
Well, and I think, too, up until this point, like, when I think of old-fashioned, like, cuddly
yeah.
stuffed animals, I think of ones that are more rigid. I don't
yeah.
know why, but then, like, I feel like as the progression of stuffed animals has gone forward,
yep.
we see that we want animals that are a little bit more plush.
Like Squishmallows, which I think, in my humble opinion... are kind of like the modern day Beanie Baby almost. It's like a
oh, 1,000%.
Different material,
yeah.
different experience, but the same kind of realm that just kind of takes everything by storm.
Yeah. I had a patient come in the other day and they brought their Squishmallow in for the, to, like, for comfort. It was really cute.
I'm going to start doing that.
You should.
I will. Hey, Centric. Ah, ooh, thanks. Kitty cats. Good to see you. Oh, nice catch, Mel. Right.
Roadkill. You were on roadkill.
I was on roadkill. So ended up Warner had the last laugh because he sold 30,000 units of the roadkill at the Atlanta Toy Fair, and by 1992 his company's catalog included dozens of different types of animals outside of cats.
Cute.
As successful as that endeavor was, though, he was not satisfied. He wanted to create a collectible toy that kids could purchase with their own pocket money, so kind of under $5 range. And mm-hmm. at the time, according to Warner, there were no toys in that range that weren't essentially garbaggio.
Gotcha.
So, he tried to make it happen. Beanie Babies were first introduced in 1993. No, Abby. By Warner, of course, at the World Toy Fair in New York City, New York. Manufacturing began in 1994, and the toys were first sold in stores located in Chicago, Illinois, for around that $5 US dollars, which is exactly where he wanted them to be. There were 9 original Beanie Babies, and they were called Legs the Frog, Squealer the Pig, which I do not like, Spot the Dog, Flash the Dolphin, Splash the Whale, Chocolate the Moose, Patty the Platypus, Brownie the Bear, which was later renamed to Cubby the Bear, and then Pinchers the Lobster, which is also very special because some of the tags were actually printed with an error and they said Punchers the Lobster, as in like punch punch.
Wow. Those are probably worth the millions that we were all promised.
Exactly, exactly. That I never received.
That's right.
So in the early years, there were, at that point, after the original 9, 50 official Beanie Babies for sale within a year, though at first, as most things that are kind of taking off, sales were slow. And by 1995, many retailers were refusing to buy the bundles that the toys were offered in, while others just refused to buy them entirely. So not a great start, considering his Himalayan cat success.
Right.
Yeah, exactly. They are cute names other than Squealer the Pig. I don't like it. Around the same time, Warner decided to restrict the quantity of Beanie Babies a store could buy, since he was already kind of, you know, not doing exactly what he wanted sales-wise. And in that case, the store would only be able to buy 36 of each character, which is apparently considered low. I don't know. I mean, if there's 50 characters and you can only buy 36 of each, I guess that's I don't know. But they also decided that over time, they would begin to Lynx, get your head out of the video, man. He's just
hello.
Both cats have invited themselves.
Yeah. The void.
The void and the floofer. Mm-hmm. I've made a path for you. Do you wish to get down? No. Okay, bye. never mind. They were also going to retire certain characters after a certain period of time, meaning that some of the characters would disappear from production altogether. Salem said, I'm back.
Hi.
Hey, Mom.
Hi.
Fur camper, exactly. But it's just meowing. Is that what we're requesting? We can make a meow compilation. I could with Puma for sure.
Yeah.
Nice bum. Love a good bum. Bye.
He's moving his way right over there. Okay.
So, what we've created, which is great, is... Only cats, yeah.
Only cats.
Do you know how much money we would make?
Oh my god.
So, perfect storm is what we've created. Number one, we've created a scenario where some are scarce. And two, we've created a scenario where some are completely rare because they're either retired or the quantity's not there. This right. is great for Warner, and it Correct. Plays out exactly the way that you might expect it to. Rarity and scarcity just move people.
Mm-hmm.
The problem is, for Warner at least, this would also kind of create a secondary market because, and I have to give this little plug, I was supposed to give it at the end, but I have to give it now. There is actually a documentary on this, and the people that were involved with this secondary market are insanity. No, we are not. However, we Mash could. Blair would not, I don't think we had sent that. We could.
We could.
We could.
We could.
How are you, Quip? Good to see you. They are, exactly. Ooh, feeling fresh, Mel. 9 fresh. On that scale. All right. So, the considerations. Word of mouth. Oh, eccentric. Gross.
Disgusting.
Word of mouth was very big for him. Most popular toys will bombard you with their ads, especially on TV. However, Beanie Babies were sold without any traditional advertising and solely relied on the customer to kind of get it around. And this created yeah. what they considered mystery. Well, yeah. Like I said,
everybody
retirement.
Likes a good mystery.
Right, exactly. They also like scarcity and rarity because it makes you feel important if you find those things. Mm-hmm. And in this case, allegedly, if you found those things, you would also be, wow, Mel, 99% mediocre. You're basically one of us.
I know. We should just invite her on the pod, honestly.
Yeah. So retirement, small stores, hard to find. Perceived limits of scarcities.
Oh, Chris is 27% mediocre.
He could really step it up, to be honest. Individuality as well is that personification. A lot of people were buying them to individualize a person, like for a birthday. So if yeah. you bought yeah. something special that you thought of that person as, that's now become something they identify with their
well, and they had... I mean, this is too early, I think, but they did have like birthday Beanie Babies, if I do remember correctly. Indeed. And like yearly ones as well, and holiday ones. Yeah.
Exactly. And okay. that's where we get to the design.
Oh, I love the design.
Yes. Oh, Centric, you are doing not that great today. I'm so sorry, man.
Wah, wah.
Mel is killing it, though. Definitely a good noodle. Jeez, Abby, also one of us.
Truly.
So outside of just the business plan, Warner made very specific choices to the construction because, as we said, he didn't want it to fit into this like stuffed everybody has it kind of scenario.
Right.
Nice with the 4 stars, Quip. Mm-hmm. Beanie Babies are deliberately understuffed, which led to criticism, of course. They called them roadkill, they called them cheap. However, it did technically set them apart, and they could be posed, which was also something new to the market, as opposed to just having one stiff look to whatever it was.
Right, right.
He said that understuffing method made the toys, quote, look real, and another important design was, of course, the very signature tie tag.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And everybody's seen it. You would
have
be
you
able-
seen the Halloween costumes where people just like tie, yes. they make it out of cardboard and then yeah. just tie it to their wrist or whatever.
It's so cute.
Super cute.
So clever. Quip knows that's my favorite word. Since the beginning, Beanie Babies have included 2 tags for identification, a heart-shaped swing tag at the top, and a fabric tush tag at the bottom, which I love.
Yes.
You would think, Abby, but apparently this was on purpose for a specific reason and also where the beads, which is what they were, where the beads are is very purposeful.
Yes.
You would think. Quip, let me fill you in. So the article that I pulled all this stuff from was literally created June 5th of this year. People are still talking about it. And they made a whole documentary about it. So you would think.
I think he means like literally dead, though, because we're trying to make the argument that they make it look more lifelike.
Oh, well. Well, yeah.
I don't know.
If they come alive at night, I don't know.
Is this a Toy Story thing?
I know, right?
Could be.
But both tags have been redesigned completely over time. In 1994 through 1996, the tags had a to and from blank, so you could use it as a gift, which again, just kind of spoke to that personalization. But also starting in early 1996, the tags would include four-line poems related to the Beanie Baby and a date of birth for the toy, which is exactly
it's
what you
so
were saying.
Cute.
It yeah. is. I know, right? Just eat it. This poem birthday concept was actually created by someone named Lena, who is credited as the author of the poems of the first 136 babies that were introduced to the marketplace. So
that's adorable.
I think a lot of it gets attributed to Warner, which obviously he was big brains in it, but he had a big team behind him that really helped him redesign and all that stuff. And his design would change, which would begin to create the craze. During a release in 1993, Warner would change the design of the colored teddy bear beanies, making their faces a little less flat and in turn creating, essentially, a retired version of the exact same bear. They were separated by collectors, eventually using the terms old face teddy and new face teddy. And during the craze, for context, two pair of them, old face teddies would be worth enough to pay for a semester of college.
Well, college was much cheaper at that time.
Fair.
I was like, wow, but that, not really.
I have not seen that, but it sounds adorable. And now I feel like I need to. But yeah, I mean, even for a stuffed animal to be able to pay for anything substantial, still kind of impressive.
Very impressive.
My Nana house, I get to inherit. Oh, that's so cute. See, my grandma. She has a German Shepherd one that was gifted to her because she was called Sarge, and its name is Sarge.
Cute. So,
yeah, Grandma has it somewhere, or maybe Suzanne has it. I'm not sure. Ah, okay. Well, YouTube it is. Maybe we should have like a movie night.
We could do that.
We also have similar to them in claw machines. Were Beanie Babies in claw machines? Do you know? Around here?
Yeah. I've seen them. It was a long time ago, though, like when we were kids. Mm-hmm. Now they have Squishmallows in there.
Fair enough. Yeah. Oh, how the turns have tabled.
Exactly.
So, final straw to Crazy Town. Here we go.
We love Crazy Town.
We sure do. With the sales structure and the design choices, frickin' Vaporeon in the chat, y'all better try to catch it, I swear. With the sales structure and the design choices, Beanie Babies were gaining a little bit of headway. However, in 1995, things would really start to get crazy because another design change, and a stuffed non-Beanie lamb that was called Lovey, had to be discontinued due to the company's Chinese supplier at the time. So they were having a lot of supply chain issues, had to just completely discontinue her. While discontinuing toys was not unusual, the response was. For the first time, Warner was faced with angry customers because apparently Lovey was a big seller in hospitals.
That makes sense.
One of Warner's distributors recalled an earlier toy maker who sold gnomes and would occasionally break the mold for one of his lines, telling customers the piece had been retired and drove up demand. Instead of mentioning the supply problems, however, Warner and his representatives told store owners that Lovey had been retired and found it completely changed the response.
So they lied.
Yes, exactly.
Cute.
Okay. Right, yes. Disappointed buyers were suddenly delighted at the prospect that the loveys they already had might be worth more than what they paid. At random.
Right.
Like, it was self-imposed, I guess.
Yeah.
And seeing this, Warner then began intentionally retiring certain ones. So maybe ones that were really popular or beloved. Nice catch, guys. Oh, Chris caught it.
Cute.
Woo. Nice. Sag, I'm so sorry, Mel. So that was huge. Lovey started the craze. They also started in that moment picking out specific ones instead of just kind of having them die out. It was very purposeful and kinetic. So that was huge. Additionally, outside of Lovey, they also made the first iteration of the Thai website, which looks very different now than when it did. And it is still in existence, but it's completely different. They have none of the original pieces. You can see the original in the documentary, which is amazing to see, honestly.
I know. I need to watch the documentary. You do. It's really good. I need to do that.
The first business-to-consumer website designed to sell to consumers directly is what was built for Thai. And to go along with the launch of the website in 1995, all Beanie Baby hang tags were printed with the Thai website URL, and a new piece of text was added to the company's name with the following message, "Visit our website." Cute. Which, of course, drove everybody there.
Question.
Yes.
If I hit share my screen, can I pull up the website and or would that like totally would that be weird?
I don't think so. Hold on.
Let me try.
I'll do you one better.
Okay.
I have a screen for this.
Of course you do.
So
one woman IT department, ladies and gentlemen.
It's not really. Let me make sure it's working correctly, though. All right, I'm going to move you for just a moment.
Okay.
All right, here we go. This is what it currently looks like.
Oh.
Can you see it?
Look at that. Yeah.
Oh, well, yay.
I can't see it like on my end, but I can see it on the.
Oh, yeah, like, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So this is what it currently looks like.
Yeah.
Which, again, watch. I can't iterate enough. Watch the documentary. When you see the before and this after, you'll be like, what happened?
Does anyone think that the ones. So, like, the old. The Beanie Babies in the 90s only had like the small little eyes, but now they have the ones with the really big eyes.
Mm-hmm.
Does anyone think that those are weird or is it just me? I feel like they're kind of, it's a little weird.
It's a little weird and I have a lot to say about it, to be honest.
Yeah.
I'm not a fan, honestly.
No, I don't like the evolution that has happened here.
It's kind of creepy.
A little bit.
Yeah. Birthday babies. I have no idea what mine is.
I don't know either.
I'd have to look it up. Yeah, I don't. Maybe that's something we can do while we're here. Is just kind of look up which Beanie Baby has our birthday. I'm sure it might actually. I say that it might actually be in the pile, but we'll see.
I'm looking right now. Hold on.
I do like Funko Pops, but I feel like they have a different vibe than a plush.
Because they're plastic.
Right. Yeah. It's just different. You know. I don't know. It's just different. Okay. Right. So they have a website. People were buying. And this would be the final marks of the Beanie Baby boom. And in its height of its popularity, people would flip Beanie Babies for as much as tenfold on eBay. And at this height, beanies made up 10% of eBay sales as a result. Some collectors insured their purchasers for thousands of dollars, and in 1998 alone, sales would shoot up to $1.4 billion. That's US dollars, mind you. Oh, Amiibos? I don't know that as well.
What is an Amiibo?
It's like a, isn't it like an electronic digital thing? I don't know. Yeah.
So I found a website.
That's cool.
That has all, you can look up your birthday and then it has all the Beanie Babies that have the same birthday as you.
Ah, it's for Switch. Okay. Yeah. Because aren't they cards too? Because I had the Amiibo cards for Animal Crossing and I could get like the Sanrio characters to visit my island that they made for the game. Is that what they are? Like the Amiibo cards? Am I crazy? Beanie
How does Chris knows? I don't know. Yeah.
Yeah. Action figures come to life in the game where you could like put them on.
Oh.
Yeah. The little plastic ones. I don't know what they look like though.
Is it like Neopets? Kind of? No? Wrong?
Neopets were just digital. So, okay. I mean, it's just like a digital character, but these were like physical that you could use to make digital.
Oh, okay.
I don't know how else to describe that to you. I'd have to show you. You should definitely look it up. Yeah, like little Nintendo character statues, like baby statues.
Okay.
Right. I'm gonna look at December then. Don't dox yourself though. Don't give out your personal info. I also have 1, 2, 3. I also have 4 with the same birthday. That's weird.
You mean 4 different? Wait, what do you
like,
mean?
Like I have 4 different Beanie Babies that share. Yeah, like Abby. Like, yeah.
I have like 8.
Crazy.
Mm-hmm.
That's what, so Centric, that's what Mel said, but it's working. Are you on mobile? Raise your hand if you're on mobile.
All right, now, this is class now.
Raise your hand if you're on mobile. Yeah, I know, Quiff. It's crazy, isn't it? You don't count, Chris. The comma after, but it's not attached to doing it. See?
It's like, I know nobody in this chat watches Ted Lasso other than Chris, but like there's a character on Ted Lasso and he doesn't like using whistles. And so, and he's one of the coaches, so he needs to use a whistle. So instead of that, he just yells, whistle, whistle. So funny.
Effective.
It's effective.
Okay. Whistle. All right. I've removed it. Okay. How about now? Okay, thank God.
Jeez.
Punctuation, man. I just wanted to use correct separating punctuation.
Can't be doing that on the internet.
Can't be doing that. It's gross. Mm-mm. All right. Let's
now
talk
we
about
got
the
that figured out.
Let's talk about the crazy people.
I love this. Okay, go ahead.
And how much is it worth? I'm sitting on the edge of my seat. Punctuation, yeah, punked me, didn't work. 500,000?
That's buy a house with that.
You could.
Mm-hmm.
I wish I have it, but won't. I know, right? It's the princess bears. They were the most mm-hmm. popular. That's insanity. You really could buy a house with that.
You could. Mm-hmm. Not in California, though.
No. No, in Monopoly money. Centric. High expectation.
I have that much money in Monopoly money.
I know, mm-hmm. right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right. Besides these crazies, we also have collector crazy, which is where we're headed next. So we've got the boom. 1996, the scarcity strategy is working, and parents, not the children, parents begin paying up to $10 to $20 for retired beanies that originally started at $5. Remember, going back there. Mm-hmm. Around this time, two pairs of women in the Chicago suburbs, which is where the documentary is taking place, there's a school teacher, Becky Phillips, and Becky Estensoro, I don't know, and Dr. Paul Benchik Abrinko and her sister Peggy Gallagher became the first serious Beanie Baby collectors, and they would take the entire thing off the charts. As retirings made certain lines scarce, these women became experts at going to track them down. They noticed, Abrinko specifically, that the hospital's gift shop sold the toys, so whenever she talked to other hospitals, at the end she asked to be transferred to their gift shop and would buy all the Beanie lines she couldn't find. Which is insanity.
So basically she stole them from all the sick people at the hospital?
Allegedly. To a point, yeah. Gallagher, meanwhile, started buying them from Ty's German distributor, allowing her to pay retail price for the lines that had virtually disappeared from Chicago shelves, such as 30 Chili the Polar Bear dolls that she got for $7 a piece and would later sell for more than $1,800 a piece.
Wow.
Insanity! Thanks for eating, Centric.
My brother had a polar bear Beanie Baby, but I don't know if it was that specific one, but that's interesting.
Could have been worth $1,800 at that time.
I know.
Apparently. All told, Gallagher ordered $2,000 worth of toys from Germany, and a few months later, those toys were worth more than $300,000. Insanity. Between Gallagher and her sister and the two Beckys, who were buying every Beanie Baby they could find in the Chicago area, interest would soar as the toys, again, became more and more scarce because these crazy ladies were buying them up.
Yeah, because these four people were buying all of them.
Every single one. Beanie Babies they could find in the Chicago area were limited, and they began calling friends throughout the country to ask them to seek other specific pieces, and in doing so, they spread what was called Beanie Mania nationwide, which is insanity to say out loud. It's just like the Pokemon cards that went absolutely nutso. We got a lot for ours. Exactly. I was very happy. Warner came to hate these women, of course, because again, they created a secondary market and they were profiting essentially off of his creation by coordinating all of this resale value, which is insane to me. And they were allowed to do it a lot. And also tried to sue them on multiple occasions. And that was a key role to making him, you know, kind of a billionaire, though, because they made this craze regarding his product, right. And then he's like, absolutely not. But just to kind of show you, it wasn't just the buying that made him mad. What really kind of took it is they started creating secondhand non-affiliated stuff, such as real print materials.
Okay.
So, in a book written by Warner's former co-worker Zach Bissonnette, it states that Gallagher would put an ad in a collector's magazine offering a Beanie price list. So this was just curated by them and, I guess, their interpretation of prices? She was creating the market, but she told the author Bissonnette was setting the prices based on nothing, as expected. And in the beginning, she simply decreed that most retired Beanie Babies were worth $10 to $20 and then watched in amazement as the market went there. Obviously.
Wow.
You're setting this, this
standard.
You're setting this random standard.
Yeah.
For those who played the market right, the profit was enormous, and they were quietly selling a few of the rarer beanies and using those proceeds to adopt her first child, actually, which was also insanity, which is good.
Can you imagine, you know? Like the like adoption lady who comes in to like vet her, and then she just like sees all these Beanie Babies like in her house?
Crazy lady.
It's like, this lady either really likes Beanie Babies or thinks that kids only like Beanie Babies.
Exactly. Or she's just crazy.
Also that.
It was definitely the latter.
Maybe she just hid them in like the garage or something.
I mean, watch the documentary.
Okay. I got it.
You know those like curio cabinets?
Uh-huh. Hmm.
Mm-hmm. Imagine like 20 of those.
Okay.
Nice catch, Abby.
Yeah.
Once Warner sales rep sold a rare beanie to finance braces for her daughter, so it's also mm-hmm. getting a little out of hand there. And for those profiting beanies, life was gold. And by 1996, the total sales had risen tenfold to $280 million. And Warner's personal income that year, pre-tax, was $90 million. Not bad, honestly.
Mm.
Now, yes, exactly. No longer a cat lady. However, as expected, all good things must come to an end.
The decline of an era.
That's exactly what it was. Mm. It fizzled out real hard.
Real hard.
Really, so much so that people just started abandoning like tubs of these things. Like actual tubs.
I feel like you're just walking down the road and you like expect to find a tub with like abandoned kittens or something, but it's actually just beanie babies.
That's exactly what happened. So one of the primary reasons of the demise of Beanie Babies was market saturation, ironically. Because again, we talked real hard mm-hmm. about the scarcity and rarity tactics. But what happened is, as people were buying them up and they were marketing. They just became so phenomenal and mm-hmm. so crazy that people were like, over it almost, because it was so much. The demand for them skyrocketed. The company began to ramp up the production against their original model of marketing strategy, and this flooded new Beanie Babies into the market, which, like I said, diluted that rarity exclusivity thing, and it exceeded the demand of the once inflated prices that were now beginning to plummet, causing this disillusionment among collectors and investors just kind of fade away, because
right.
there were so many to find.
I wonder if this was like in the era where they were like in the Hallmark stores and mm-hmm. in like the boutique stores. Because I remember specifically going to like the downtown area of my hometown, and there was like a bunch of different like little boutiques with like soap and you know, dish towels, and you know, you guys have all been in one of those stores.
Tchotchkes.
And exactly. And then there's always like a rack of like Beanie Babies, and I feel like that was this era, because like nobody really, they were just like pretty, I don't know, you know, and like cute, but not worth anything.
It's exactly what happened. Exactly, Chris. It happens a lot. Good night, Abby. Rest well.
Bye.
Additionally, they made their own strategic decisions that would negatively impact their own line over at Ty. They would also introduce larger and more expensive lines of Beanie Babies, such as Beanie Buddies and Beanie Kids, and that failed to resonate strongly with collectors because it veered off.
It was too kitschy.
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
And it didn't capture the original market.
Exactly.
Additionally, the company launched new ventures. They launched trading cards, which I did have.
Beanie Baby trading cards?
Yes, I might even still have them.
Oh my God.
I'm not going to go. They're buried back there and I'm not doing
We like dropped Beanie Babies and went straight to Webkinz. Like we were that.
You were that.
Yeah, exactly.
I did not hop on the Webkinz.
Oh, we were on the Webkinz bandwagon for a long time.
I love that for you.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And then it was Webkinz to Nintendogs. And then Nintendogs. I don't know what happened after that. There was like nothing after that. And like
we liked the robo dog things.
Oh yeah. Mm-hmm. And then the For Real Friends.
Yep. That was also big. Yep.
Yeah. basically robots that had like animal
qualities
or like plush fabric over them to make them look like an animal.
Did it really?
No.
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 Absolutely.
I wanted
not.
A puppy. My parents got me a for real friend. That's the way it is.
That's so sad.
I know.
So obviously, popularity started to decline, as you can see, yes. because you guys veered off as well. My mom veered off. She was the beginning of the start of the obsession of collecting these things.
Mm-hmm.
And then it just kind of petered out. Moreover, the advent of the internet rose e-commerce that would significantly impact the collectibles. Online platforms would provide greater transparency and pricing, which was huge. So no more of this just making up a price and having it set to these crazy standards of thousands of dollars for a plush, right?
Right.
It would also connect buyers and sellers directly, and that would diminish the influence of traditional collectible stores where they were found in almost exclusively. Allows collectors to assess the true value, reduce speculative nature of trading, hype was dying, and it lasted up through 1999, which would be the decline of the company altogether, and quote, be called the end, which is the final Beanie Baby bear that was made as a result.
I mean, they're clearly still like selling stuff.
Yes. So they definitely, as you could see from their website, started and maintained the divergence that they had originally.
Mm-hmm.
But the original is gone, unfortunately.
Yeah. I'm on eBay right now and somebody's trying to sell a rhino from 1996 for $1,300.
I wouldn't.
Uh-uh.
Yeah, no.
No. No.
This also means, though, that because the company was declining, collectors were also declining. There's a guy, Chris Robinson, who had played Dr. Rick Weber on General Hospital, if you know that show. Until about 10 years prior, he had invested around $100,000 in Beanie Babies, hoping that what he would sell them for would pay for his kids' college educations. And in the end, he lost every penny and still has over 20,000 Beanie Babies at his home.
Wow.
That sucks.
It's a lot.
It's terrible. So, I wanted to put a pin in this because at the beginning, we talked briefly about the fact that he was fired from his job, Warner was.
Mm.
And this is why I think the story of Beanie Babies is a little more dark for me. Because everybody just, you know, they're just collectibles, like whatever. But the man behind them was actually a little bit of a jerk, it sounds like. So despite designing toys, Ty was first and foremost a salesman, which
mm-hmm.
not all but some I have my opinions about, and was focused, it seems, on making the dollar, and that's pretty much it. Stitch! There he is. Additionally, while technically a toy, you would find very few, Ty probably included, who considered them toys and instead collectible, and that would seep into the adult world, which was the source of its ultimate popularity, and they were also the ones kind of
same. I also love Stitch. Sorry to entertain you.
No.
Sorry to interrupt you.
Sorry to entertain you also.
Sorry. Yeah, so I just had to bring this out for just a brief moment. But anyway.
He's so cute.
I think so.
Ty was less popular with people and was considered less than a people person, and that's where the book written about him from his former coworker Zach is born. Bissonette states that Warner was a smart-assed shithead.
Cute.
And he said, "I would guess you're going to be hard-pressed to find anybody who liked him."
Oh, no.
Yikes. His book was filled of Warner's miserly not misery.
Miserly.
Miserly cruelties, such as when his father passed, which we discussed. Bissonnette writes that he waited 5 days to tell his sister so he could clear out his father's antique collection.
Oh my God.
Once during the peak of his wealth, he even took a friend's young daughter out for ice cream, but made her get money from her parents to pay for it.
Okay, that's creepy though.
Also creepy, but
yeah, we don't stand that at all.
And that hubris would ultimately end his 15-year career at Dokken, where he was originally employed as his salesman and began secretly creating his own toy line, the Himalayan Cats, on the side. When his boss found out, he was immediately fired.
Seems reasonable.
He ain't great.
Not a great role model.
No, yeah. I would not suggest taking him as a role model. But all that is to say, I have show and tell materials.
Show and tell.
I'm just going to verge off of the negativity. So he was awful, but the thing is,
sometimes awful people make nice toys. I don't know what to tell you.
Well, and clearly that's the basis for his reasoning to being mad at these women as well. About a shit. Yeah. Yeah. Veer off a shithead. Yes, it sounds just like H. You know, I don't think you've seen me play Slime Rancher, but there is a guy, no. H, who's leaving all these messages around the island, and he is also a little weird.
Oh.
Slime Rancher 1 was odd. It's just a little weird.
That is weird.
All right. You guys know of my plushie collection. What you don't know is what was hidden in my bookcase. So I'm going to show you.
In the secret door. No, I'm just
kidding. Secret door. Secret tunnel.
Secret tunnel.
B for papas. It's a papa's party. It's a papa's party. Okay. I got these from McDonald's way back when.
Oh my gosh, they're so cute. We had McDonald's Beanie Babies too.
So this one is Twigs and this one is Lefty. Obviously it's a giraffe and a donkey. But they had these little minis in the McDonald's Happy Meals. And you really did feel like you had to collect them all. Obviously these aren't in
that
the
was
shape.
Another, like, speaking of collectible things, like mm-hmm. any McDonald's toy, like, they had only 4 or 5 different variations of the toy
exactly.
in the McDonald's Happy Meal. And so you would have to go back to get each one to complete the set or whatever. And, I mean, we never did any, but, like, some people did, and it was a huge deal.
Brown underwear by Blair's name. It's obviously not. What do you have on your wall back there?
What's happening? Oh. Yeah. So that is here. I'll clarify. Let me see.
Literally
going
wood.
Going off the rails. Going off the rails.
It's a coin holder, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a coin holder. There we go.
There you go. Yeah. Not even close. All right.
Let me see if I can fix it.
We're
fixing it.
One of the first ones that I got was Osito, which is this one. Very cute. Oh, this is kind of appropriate. Teddy Ursa in the chat. It's a bear. How appropriate. I know, right? Forever and always.
Awkward.
So, Osito. And then I got what is known as the 10 years Beanie Baby Kissy. Which
cute.
Is super cute.
Yes.
And he's got, so the thing is, they like tell you it's got like a special tag or whatever. It's holographic.
Right. Yeah. There's like 25 year, yeah. I think, too. And yeah.
Exactly. I also have Knuckles the pig, not Squealer the pig. Blair, where'd you go? Blair said, I'm out.
What happened?
I don't know either. Bye, Blair. Mod check, Blair. you could have just said you didn't want to be here anymore.
No, I had no
no control over situation. All of a sudden it was just chat. And I was like,
it's just chat. That must have been scarier. I also have Bongo. This is cute Bongo. Little monkey.
What a cute name.
But he's missing his tag, so, you know. Yeah, stream's over. I'm out. I have so many. I'm just going to bore you with it because I have no one else to show and they just shit on my shelf.
Shit on your shelf.
Let's see. Who are you? This is Cuckoo.
Cute.
I guess. It's like Kirsten sure is prattling on time to tip.
Bye.
Get this girl. I mean, full disclosure, we did record a podcast today, so we have seen a lot of each other today.
It's been a day.
So yeah, it wouldn't surprise me. I also have Hoofer, which I felt.
Oh, I had that one. You I do? Had that one too.
Oh my God. Horse girls.
Yes.
Horse girls. Love. Here's the problem. I hate the name. Why would you name it Hoofer?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure I renamed all my Beanie Babies because I hated all their names.
Yeah, exactly. Did you have Fairy Tail, who was the other horse-like one?
I did not.
No. Well, you know why I have only
this one. Only had because of Busch Gardens.
That's why. Exactly why I have mine.
See?
That's why. You can tell we lived in the same area for a while.
It's true.
There was also a collection called the Zodiac Collection. I am the rooster, so I have the rooster. No.
Unfortunately. The way that you set that up was like... There's the Zodiac Collection, and unfortunately, I am. And I was like, the Zodiac Killer?
Revealed after all this time. Mel's the rat.
Zodiac Killer? Kirsten is the Zodiac Killer?
Sweet. No. Oh, Rooster, God. I am the rat, who has now been pinned. Thank you, Cedric. but I do have an alternative. I have the dragon as well. He's kind of cool.
Cute.
I like him. But then what started happening is they got kitschy. And so they they started getting into other genres. So this is Hedwig.
For Harry Potter.
For Harry Potter, of course.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, dragon. I know, right? Mod check dragon in chat. And then dragon D is nuts. Kinda.
Yeah. Okay.
Then here's where things get weird. You just told me that you didn't like the big eyes. I received my very first Beanie Boo.
Yeah.
That's from
what they're called. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
From Caden.
Oh, okay.
So I couldn't. You know,
Caden's her little brother, so you can't say no to that. It's like when a toddler calls you on a fake phone, you have to answer it.
You have to answer. Thing.
It's cute.
This is what I got.
Yeah.
And it's called Stripes. Obviously.
Seems reasonable.
However, yeah. I duped myself. Because I just bought this one.
It's so cute, though.
And it's huge.
It is huge.
His name is Grendel.
I think it makes it better that he has the little flappies over the eyes.
Yes, I would agree. It's not as aggressive as this one.
Yeah.
Which that just one stares into your soul.
Right.
I know, Spyro.
Spyro. Mm-hmm.
Just a different version, I guess.
Flames.
And that's it.
I like it.
So... Anyway, SawCon? No, I have not. SawCon these nuts? Is that what you're going to say? Because I could beat you to it. Hi, Brandy. How are you? Brandy also streams. She's lovely.
I know. I follow her, actually.
You
Hi, Brandy.
Do? So cute. Oh, my God. I know. Yes, Spyro's emo version. Exactly. This is his emo face.
Right. Everybody goes through one.
longtime listener first. She and Kate listened to our podcast.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. So many. We have so... I did not expect this many. I didn't think Chris was going to be here, so... The yeah. chat is mostly mods, except for Quip.
Yeah. Yeah.
And Abby, I guess. But Abby's asleep, so...
Yeah, fair. Oh, my I mean, God. She deserves it. It's really late there.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And Chris is actually leaving. He has to go... He's in this little golf league thing, so he has to go do that.
I thought he left earlier.
So he did. He did a golf lesson.
Don't you dare.
Break. He's on break right now. So he did a golf lesson this morning, and now he's going to go play 9 holes of golf.
Good Lord.
I know. It's moderately so much golf. Annoying. Do you know what you call a significant other that gets left by their husband or their boyfriend, husband, whoever, to go play golf? You call them a golf widow.
A golf widow?
Yes.
Oh my God.
That's what the internet calls them.
That's so intense.
They leave you for like afternoons or whatever. It's fine though. I don't mind.
You know what though? I saw... I forget who was I talking to? Oh my God. It was at work. The call for. Yeah, exactly. I was talking to my team at work about golf because my boss was saying how he like hurt his back, and that's just a very typical thing I think of people who golf, unfortunately.
It does happen. Yeah.
But my coworker, the one who I work the closest with, she was telling me that she was telling me like, I didn't think too much about golf. And she's like, how many holes is it? And we're like 18. And she's like, that's a lot. And we're like, it lasts all day. And she's like, I could find so many better things to do in that time. And I was like, exactly. And my boss was like, yeah, you get up and you get invited and you're like, oh, this is, yeah, sure. I'll meet you out there. Like, let's go.
So some would say it's a good walk spoiled, right?
Yeah,
because
right.
There's like, yeah. But also the thing is they're not like growing up, Philip and my brother and my dad would go and like play golf, and it would be, they would leave at like, you know, 7 in the morning and then not get back till like 2 or 3 in the afternoon.
Yep.
But the thing is they're not like necessarily doing anything during that time. They're just like drinking, and then they take a break for lunch after 9 holes, and they just take their leisurely time. It's like not, you know, it's not like other sports. Know what I mean?
Exactly. No, we don't have a team, but Chris, I guess he's
no team.
No team. Okay.
No, he just goes and plays, and
there were definitely holes everywhere. Yeah. I don't mind golf. I'm just not very good at it. And I'm very impatient.
So, I actually played my first 9 holes of golf the other day.
Oh, how was that?
And it was good. It was good. We played it in a way. So Chris and I are both like kind of bad at golf.
Hence the lessons.
And, right. Yeah. So, and he's way more into it than I am. But we both like, we played. So whoever got the better shot, we played from that ball. So that way it didn't take as long, and I didn't get as frustrated because I hit it a long time, you know, farther away, whatever, you know.
Anyway. You know what I mean?
You know what I mean?
Golf terms. Quip, I have no idea what those are.
Yeah, I'm lost. I don't know.
No idea.
No idea.
You lost me.
Yeah.
Well, ironically, now that Brandy is here, I've run out of material. Other than, please go watch. So the documentary is called Beanie Mania. That's literally what it's called. Highly recommend it. Oh, I get it. It's our name.
Oh, it's our couple's name.
It's our couple's name. Are we a couple now?
We're podcasting couple.
Blasting. Yeah, it does sound better. Blasting. We're blasting off. No. That's not what I meant.
Not true. We just literally have nothing left on our sheet here. We have no other things to say.
Don't even recognize our own name in chat. You know what? It wouldn't be mediocre content otherwise. So I feel like we are at least true to our brand.
We are. We named it that for a reason.
Very good reason. Honestly. I am not ashamed.
No, not even a little bit.
Oh my god, that's legit. I do like Blastin' better, though.
Blastin' is good.
Yeah.
Crier?
I was going with Crier, which is just what I am and doesn't really need to be out there. It's just my personality, and I don't need that in public.
You know what? It's one thing to cry in private, but to like be advertising it everywhere, it's a little different.
It is a little different. Well, you know what I haven't done? I haven't made a screen with all of our things that we normally say at the end, like, if you have any suggestions, send them to blah, 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 you know? It is a little weird, but yeah. We're a little weird. I should make one of those, I guess.
You could, yeah. We could just say it, too. It's fine.
Yeah, that's true. Also don't need really a screen because I guess I'm a bigger idiot and I could just do that. Those are our socials, as you guys are aware.
We finally fixed it after all this time.
After all this
time. It took us an hour and 23 minutes and 3 mods to figure it out.
But you know what? That's why the mods are here.
That's right.
To help us fix our problems. They're such good little googies.
Yeah.
Indeed. You can reach us there. If you don't listen to our podcast, I do take it personally at this point.
Wow. She said, I hate you.
Leave. Get out. Well, no, that was you. That was totally you. If I remember correctly. Yeah.
If you want to listen to our podcast, we would totally appreciate that. If you don't, because you don't have time for that, we understand. You can always meet us here. It's fine.
Yeah. Every other Thursday, as it says. I guess we should figure out a good raid option. Anybody have a raid suggestion you may choose at your leisure?
Oh, yes. We should. I got nothing.
I'm going to look and see. Oh, I'm Reverb. Ah! Going right there.
Are we putting this on YouTube now? What are we doing?
I plan to. I'm hoping the VOD actually saves this time.
I would hope so.
I turned it on? That sounds weird. I made it an op.
What happened?
What is this? Abs is live. Thank you. Dave, Anna, Abs, Lance, Azalea, Sam, Sajace. Maybe we do Abs. We'll get you a YouTube link.
Yeah.
Oh, is Sam live? Oh, you said Sam too. Read my money chat before posting on YouTube. Where is it, babe? Hold on.
Okay. Waiting. Bueller.
Ah! Good point. I'll tell you later.
Okay.
Good point. Thank you, Brandy. Okay. I'll talk to her about it then. That's what made me gasp when I went. Okay, hold on. Before we go.
Okay.
Let me show you what. Let me show you what Gwen put in here. Oh no, I've moved the whole background. One moment, please. It's gonna make you a little uncomfortable, so prepare yourself.
Oh no. What's happening?
If a spider wore pants. Brandy, so you've seen this. Great. I don't know the answer, but I'm incredibly uncomfortable.
So, okay. So all right. The one on the top right looks like a onesie.
It does.
So I don't like that one. But also, I feel like the one on the top left, it looks like too little of pant.
Too little of pant.
Yes.
Okay.
Because, and then, so I feel like the middle one on the bottom is the only logical answer, but also looks the strangest.
Are we going with logical answer for that? Really?
Yeah.
It does not fully cover the booty. You're right.
Right, that's what I'm saying. The top left definitely, it looks like plumber's crack. Like there's a little bit of butt crack that's like still showing. I agree.
Trick question, they don't wear pants.
But if they did though.
But if they did. If they did, you would certainly not want plumber bum.
Right. That's what I'm saying. Spiders have a lot going on.
That's unfortunate, Quip. I don't know. Weird. Happy for you though. Right. Okay. Well, side spider bum. Free the booty. It's actually, isn't it like free the anthrax? Isn't that what it's called?
Anthrax is what you mail to people if you want them to die. That's not what it is.
What am I thinking of?
I don't know.
Thorax.
Thorax. That's what it is.
And they call me a scientist.
We're just out here trying to kill people.
I was just trying to give the spiders the proper name for their pants region. Oops. So sorry. I meant thorax. I promise.
The FBI is in the chat now. Yeah,
the FBI has entered the chat. Damn it. I tried so hard.
Oh my god.
I forgot. Who are we? Who are we rating? Oh, abs. Hold on. Let me look her up. Wow. All right, I'm gonna pause this. Get out of here, Spotify. How loud is this gonna be? Oh, so loud. Nope. Nice, I got our music on. We're not milking spiders, Quip. All right. What are the numbers? I'm in a different Twitch right now. Can somebody give me Abs's like full name, please? It's not coming up for some reason.
Oh, we got it. 96.
Thank you. Lord. There's your raid message for when we go over. Okay. Perfect. All right, guys. Well, thanks for joining us.
Indeed. It's been a blast.
It has been a blast.
Congratulations to us on our second stream.
On our second stream. It's amazing. I love all of you guys so much. Thanks for joining. We really appreciate it. I'm going to start the raid. It is going to go over to Abs, so make sure to send her tons of love. And now it's not working, of course, so it's just a struggle. I do. Did that work? Please, God. All right, it did. We'll see you guys next time. I hope you have a great day. evening, night, whatever, Blair, anything for you?
Nothing. Cheers.
Cheers. We'll see you guys later.
We out.